Yes, I'm very, very, very happy to give a talk to such a high quality audience. I'm going to talk about traditional geometric art, but more precisely that kind of geometric art that have seen extraordinary development in the world of Islam. Such a development that this art is known as Islamic geometric art. But in my point of view and my experience, it's just geometric art. And why it has seen such a development in the Islamic culture, it's a very controversy issue. There is no obvious answer for that. I want to go to quasi crystal, but first, of course, I have to give a brief introduction to Moroccan and Persian style of geometric art. I can go to quasi crystal via the process of self-similarity, but not only. But the self-similarity, I think that everybody here, everybody know more or less, have an idea of what is self-similarity. And this image is my favorite image to give an idea of what it is. Of course, it's from M.C. Escher. Quasi crystal is come from the experience in crystallography. Okay, you have to know that before 1982, scientists believed that in any material, the atom can be arranged in two different ways. First way is just random. Random, okay. If it's not random, it's order. And if it's order, it's that kind of strict order of crystals. What is a crystal? It's a kind of paving of the space that can be made from a cell unit which is repeated along the three directions of the space in a regular way. And after an experimentation in 1992, we realized that there is something which is order, which is long-run order, which is not disorder, but it's a kind of organization which is not periodic. It's a long-run order, but it's not a crystal. It's not the strict order of the crystal where always the same thing is repeated. So I have to talk a little bit of what is a diffraction phenomenon, because when we have a material, when scientists want to have a new material, they want to know more about the structure. And so something very powerful to search about the structure of the material, basically to know if is it a crystal or not, is to use diffraction. What is diffraction? So you have this material and you shoot a ray of light or something that behaves like light, and the light is affected by the structure of the material, and what you get here on the screen, it's a figure that gives you some information about the structure, about the microscopic structure. It works like, I can show you, maybe this. Yesterday it was a sunny day, so I did a photography for you. So I turn my camera to the sun with the minimum aperture, of course, and I got this. And you can see with your eyes, you never see the sun like this. You know, we have that kind of strange ray. So what are these rays? If I count, there's 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7 rays. So with But now I know with that that the diaphragm of my lens have a set sevenfold symmetry, even if I never look at my lens before. And of course, if I look at my lens, you see it's a 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6 sevenfold. It's very so. Diffraction makes visible something that you cannot see directly. Here it's another image of the diffraction. What is it? It's a diffraction from light going through a small window. Here, I know that the window is the shape of the window is circular because there is no special symmetry. And here, I can know that the window have that kind of symmetry, that are the symmetry of the square. So the shape of the window is a square, even if it's very small and I cannot see it. And what happened in 1982, it was Denis Feffman working on metallic alloy. He got something, and he does the diffraction experiment, and he got this. So, what he say? Ah, first thing, I got a crystal. Why? Because this is not a halo, it's a discrete amount spots. That's the signature of a crystal. So, okay, I have a crystal, but I have symmetry. So he starts counting the axes of symmetry. One axis, two axes, three, four, and five. So what he did is to count in the reverse side, and he find again fivefold symmetry. So and this is a problem. Why? Because this is supposed to be a crystal, and a crystal cannot have fivefold symmetry. It's absolutely forbidden. So through this image, the material say, I am a crystal, and at the same time say, I cannot be a crystal. So there is a problem. It's such a problem that Feffman didn't absolutely understand what happened. He went to the crystallographer who said, oh, you have to redo the experience. It can be a math, an artifact, etc. But he didn't want to the good person who are mathematician. And it takes 2 years before he met the good person. And together they published in 1984 the first paper on quasicrystal, and saying that this is not absolutely not an artifact, it's a new kind of organization of matter, which is not disorder, which is long distance order, but it's not periodic, it's not a crystal, it's something new. And they have mathematical model to explain that kind of that thing. Because it's in three dimension, more or less the same thing that is well known from mathematicians from the years 1917, with a Penrose pattern, with a non-periodic pattern. Penrose pattern is in two dimension, use a limited set of tiles. It can be only two tiles, and with tiles, we can fill patterns as two-dimensional space with symmetry of five, but it's not. But it's only local symmetry. It cannot be complete symmetry. So, Feffman here. Bletch is here. John Kahn is here, and Denis Gracias is here. So now, how can we make quasicrystal in a mathematical point of view? There is a very elegant construction. This kind of structure can be considered as coming from a very regular pattern, but that is not, that not belongs to the actual space, three-dimensional space, but belongs to the hyperspace of dimension 4, 5, 6 or any. So the quasicrystal can be considered as a section, a three-dimensional section of a hyperspace, which is patterned in a very simplest, in the simplest simplest way, with just a hypercube, regular hypercube. So these complex things can come from something very simple, but that we cannot touch, because it belongs to the hyperspace. Difficult to imagine, but the simplest way is to start with dimension not 3, not 2, but 1. I want to pattern the space of dimension 1, which is a line. For this, I start for the hyperspace. In the point of view of a line, the surface is a hyperspace, because it's the dimension 2. So I start from this is a pattern, the most simple and regular pattern in the space and two-dimensional space. And there is my line, and I want to pattern. I will pattern the line with a segment, one-dimensional tiles are segments. I get something like that. And here it's very simple, because all the tiles are the same, and I got this serial. So it's clear that it's periodic, simple periodic. Now, more interesting to make a rotation of the line. Here, the line is passing by two vertex of the grid. Okay, so I do the same thing. I consider the intersection. Okay, it works nicely. I have a pattern which is, of course, a repetitive pattern, because this triangular, you can find it the same here and so long. So, but the only problem is that, you know, here I have three tiles. You can imagine that if I move a little bit this vertex for in another place, maybe I can have a pattern with 4, 10, or 1,000 different tiles, which is not very practical. So what I want is a pattern with a limited set of tiles that works in any case. So here there is something very elegant, I think. Well, I consider here only the square of the grid that cross the line, and half of them it's enough. Now I consider the vertex here, and what I do is a projection of the vertex onto the line. So you see what is projected in terms of segment. This one, the horizontal one, come here. The vertical one, come here. So I have only two segments, two tiles. And now, so I got a new tiling of the same line, but with only two tiles, which is much more nicer. And of course, here is a periodic pattern. It's a periodic pattern because my line is passing by two points. That means that the ratio between, in this rectangle, the ratio between the height here and the length is a rational number. But you are a mathematician, you perfectly know that rational numbers are nothing, are very few compared to irrational numbers. So you can imagine that if I move a little bit my, the line, just rotation, now the ratio between this in this gradient, the ratio to the height and the yes and the length will be irrational number. But my construction works again. This triangle only the half. Projection. Here the projection is orthogonal. It don't have to be orthogonal. It can be as long as it's parallel projection. And again, what I got is a pattern of this line with only two tiles. Okay. And of course, it's this cannot be periodic because of irrational numbers. So, you see, with in one dimension, it's my interest is pattern in two dimensions. So you can imagine, I can get that kind of pattern from a hyperspace of three, four, or more dimensions. So, for example, it works like that. If I start for a space of dimension 4. What I do? Yeah. And I cut this space with a surface, a plane surface. What I got is that. So it's a pattern with only two tiles, square and rhombus. Oh, you can say, oh, it's there is some symmetry here. Because it depends of the place I cut the where I cut the place the space with the surface. I can't put my surface here or there. It depends. So I can get something like that. But mostly I will get something like that, like that, like that. There is no more symmetry at all. In dimension, if I start on dimension 5, again in a special space, okay, I got that kind of things. Again, you can say there is a symmetry axis, but it's only a local axis. Here, the symmetry is broken, and here is broken, etc. I can go some very strange things, like that, like that, like that. Okay. Yeah. You see. Of course, I can't start from any dimension. For example, what kind of space? What the dimension you like for this space? A hyperspace. Let's say 17. Okay, a little bit like that, and I cut the space in a random way. If I cut it in the particular space, I got that kind of things. But if I cut in somewhere else, the symmetry is broken, and here, the symmetry is absolutely broken. So it's a dimension 17, so I know that I have 8 different kind of rhombus here. So now, how can I use this system for my artwork in connection with the very simple traditional pattern. So, an example here. If I look at the Iranian geometric pattern, geometric style, the most important family of patterns is the family of 5. In Morocco, it's 8. In Iran, it's 5. So, and this is the simplest pattern, and this one can be seen everywhere from Granada in Spain to maybe India, I don't know, at least Iran, Afghanistan, everywhere. This pattern is crossing the whole world of Islam, and we can have different variations, of course. Where this pattern comes from? Because if I want to understand this pattern, okay, I could have a instruction of use, you take the compass, and you do this and this, this, and you get the pattern. But the nicer way is to know where this pattern comes from. So there is, I can show you the history of this pattern. The only things to do is to open the space of the golden section. And in this space, you have a lot of stars, nice little stars. What I like to do is to dance, only nothing else but to dance. And you see that at the center of the dance comes this pattern. And this star is the simplest tenfold star, and you can see everywhere. So you see there is no calculation, nothing. We just follow the history of the story of this space pattern. But of course, if I want to pattern the space with that, I have to sacrifice some symmetry, and the simplest option is that. And this is the pattern you can find everywhere, like that. Maybe you can say that this pattern is nothing but a rectangle. Yes, it's a rectangle under the condition that you identify the top, the bottom, and of course the right and the left. It means that the topology, you know, the topology of a repetitive pattern on the infinite plane, is the same as the topology of the finite surface of the torus. Okay. So but there is always at least many ways to look at the same thing. You see here, now I can consider this pattern made of not rectangular, but rhombus. And this is more dynamic way, because now I can do something else with my rhombus. So you recognize, you know very well that kind of rhombus. They are the same as the one used in a Penrose pattern. And inside, it's the second rhombus used in Penrose patterns. So let the line run, and I get decoration of this rhombus. So now I have these two tiles, and with that, some strange things can happen. If I come back to here, come back to dimension 5. So what can I do now? Maybe like that. have to. Again. So now the simplest way to use quasicrystal in connection with traditional patterns will be to use decoration of this two different tiles to map traditional pattern on it. Because these are the shapes we just have seen before. So it can be something like that. Okay. Maybe I have to go closer. So that kind of thing. So what is traditional here? It's the shape themselves, because there is nothing new. Each shape is well known, it belongs to the traditional set of tiles. But the way they are put together, it's something strange, something new. Here, of course, it's there is a center of symmetry, but if I do something like that, there's no symmetry anymore. But the tiles are the standard tiles. And in I can do same in a dimension 4, for example, like that. And I can use any kind of decoration of the tiles. Yes, can be, for example, like that. Okay. So this is not exactly a traditional pattern, but it works nicely. Again, here you have a center of symmetry, but you can have it different way. Okay, so that's the simplest way to use the theory of quasicrystal. I have to talk a little bit about traditional patterns, first Moroccan patterns. So the most important number in Morocco is the 8. The most important family of patterns come from the octagon here. And it can be made on plaster, made on metal, made on wood or painted wood. But the best technique for geometry patterns is certainly the technique of Zellige. That means that each tile is cut separately, and after we have a million, hundred tiles, and we have to make the puzzle. So if the tiles are not well designed, it cannot work. So the constraint of the techniques force to have good geometry. And it works like that. That's the lab. And like it, in any lab, you have the power supply here, which is a mint tea. You have the material, basic material, which is a tile, ceramic tiles, glazed ceramic tiles. You have models here, and here that's high technology things with this very sophisticated and simple tools. And you have the security devices and everything in the lab. So just an example, what you need to know, because this belongs to the octagonal family, just look at this. That's the main structure of the pattern. So first thing we have to do is to search for that kind of very simple structure made with only two tiles. And after, we can fill in inside. Not all the patterns are made like that, but a lot. And I call this structure a skeleton of the pattern. Of course, we can have in Morocco pattern with stars with many symmetry until that one made by it's a contemporary one made last year with my friend Malem Azeddin Bouzouba. And so you can imagine that it's not very easy to cut that kind of tiles. It's not easy at all. So how does it work? As often, it works from the simplest thing to the more complex. I start with the simple, and with very simple transformation, I go to complexity. I show you just the beginning of the story. So this is octagon. If you can draw a square, you can draw two squares and have an octagon. It's not difficult at all. So the story starts with repetition of the story. Repeat the thing. So I get this. So I had one tiles. Now I have two tiles. I have the star. Now I have star and cross. And what can I do? Simple things. You see here, maybe I can have a square here. I design the square, I got another tile here. Maybe I have to have something here. I can put a star or a cross. And in any case, I find new tiles are coming. And here now I have to put something inside, of course, a star. Here, look at the line. The line are not, this line is not very happy because both they want to join together like that. And now it's this one is not happy because his line is forced to change direction. But in fact, the two want to join together like that. Okay, so I got new tiles and what I would say, yes, that here I have kind of wings. Well, I could have more wings here. And that's the way I got this pattern, which is one of the very simple pattern, but now it's really the beginning of the story that go to more and more complex, but no time to talk more about that. But the point is that the complexity is not in the tiles themselves. The tiles are very simple. You see, each angle is multiple of 45 degrees. In fact, all along of that story, you get more and more tiles are falling down like that. And this is a part of the set of the traditional tiles. And you can consider the octagonal star as the mother of each tile. Because look at, for example, this one. It's clear that it comes from the star, this one too. This one is not that obvious, but you see the tile is inside the octagon, etc. So if you can draw the octagon, you can draw any tile. It's another. Now, Iranian style. Of course, it's the most important number, it's 5. Yes, here. No, here. Here, that's the set of tiles, my set of tiles for one of the two family of pentagonal pattern in Iran, in a Persian style. why? I can no time to explain why, but consider that I have two kinds of tiles. The red I call positive and the black I call negative because I can use only, for example, I can use only the positive because the tiles come together, they are connected by vertex in respect with the continuity of the line. And if I want to close the space with this, that's all the solution I can get. And look at the shape of the hole in between. It's exactly the shape of the negative tiles. So I can use only negative or only positive, for example. I can try to do this quickly. Go like this, like that. One again, and here I need to use this with like this. It goes here, and you see the shape of the hole is a positive. But I can do something else. I can do like this, like that. I need another one like that. Yes, it goes here, and one thing is missing, and I have what I need here. Like. So, these are the two most important patterns in this family. So the point is that this set of tiles I define independently. When I went to Iran, I realized that this set of tiles is correspond to the traditional set that Iranian artists called Kond and Shol. So my system, my set, is exactly the Kond plus Shol. And the Kond is this subsystem. This subsystem is very, very interesting. Just one thing is that this tile, you never see the black tile like this, because there is always something inside. So no time to go further. I have to go to self-similarity. So self-similarity in Morocco, no time. I skip it. So self-similarity in Persian style. we have that kind of pattern. It's clearly a two-level pattern. You see the blue lines draw a very standard pattern, which is in fact periodic. It's a part of the simplest pattern of this family. And we have a second level. And can we have a third level? So if we have a third level, so okay, we can say this is a perfect self-similar system. In fact, okay, you can say at the second level, I have the same kind of tile than at the first level. For example, I have a pentagon here. So this is the inflation walls for the pentagon. I can take these things, can reduce to the scale of the small pentagon. I put it in place of the pentagon, and I have the first level. But I have to do it for each tile. For example, for the tile which is the small tiles here, I have the roll here, etc. But look, we have that kind of tile. And this tile, which is called Sormedan, you do not have it at the first level. And as far as I know, I never have seen this tile at the first level. There is some exception, but that don't work nicely. So, and this is a problem for me, because I don't understand why. Because the artists they have so much imagination, they were so clever. Why they don't did that? Because, of course, I did a systematic research. I show you only the results. So I start from, for example, I can start for this special tiles, and that is my inflation rule, and I can do that to the third level, and at the fourth level, now I know I have everything I need to be sure that my pattern is absolutely self-similar. Huh? And I can go from, from this tile, again, first level, second, third, fourth, and here. The funny thing is that this level, the symmetry of the tile is broken. So I have at least three different systems, but I show you just one, only one. And because I want to go to excuse me. Yes, I want to go to quasi-crystals. So I like to use this image to introduce quasi-crystal in connection with the traditional pattern. This is one of my work with a British architect, Norman Foster. And I like very much this one. if you look closely, you can find where is tradition here. Tradition is in the fact that here you have octagon, you have octagonal star, and that's all on the octagonal. That's tradition spot. But the way they're organized is, of course, it's a, you have a fractal process and a quasi-crystal organization. No time to give you more details. I can give you after if you need. So, quasi-crystal, very fast, in Morocco. In Morocco, three occurrences of the possibility of quasi-crystal. There is a potential of quasi-crystal. Remember, remember the image with the skeleton. I told you that, for example, if I want to fill this space, I need first to search a skeleton, that can be this one, that one. So it could be nice to have a grid for the skeleton. And it happened that I designed that grid, and I was thinking, it looks, can I get this grid from an inflation process? And in fact, yes, it works nicely. It works like that. And this can be continued infinitely, of course. And in fact, this is nothing else than the inflation process for Amman patterns. So this can go to octagonal quasi-crystals. And the funny thing is that it works also for the for that kind of structure, decorative structure that is used for dome or that kind of things, and we call mukarna. You see, it's same figure in the background. So I can now I have to skip some things. Now I just want to show you. Another occurrence of a quasi-crystal, and this came when I was working for another project with Foster, because I realized that each type can be broken into square and rhombus. With also half square, but when you put the tiles together, each half square finds his friend, and at the background you have what it is here. It's an, of course, here is the approximant of Amman pattern, but it can turn to octagonal quasi-crystal if you want. And same thing if I add breads. Yes. So it means that any pattern of this family could be made with only two tiles. This can be interesting. So three possibilities of quasi-crystals. Application, no time. Now I will end with a quasi-crystal from the Iranian style. So there are some results that come again from a work I did with Foster. It was a very nice project for the Federal National Council of the Emirates. Unfortunately, for some reason, for economic reason, this project will never be done. So, what come here? This come in two times. First, I was thinking, can I do with the pentagonal style what I did with the octagonal? Can I do a rhombic dissection of the tiles? So, what the tile I use? The rhomb I use, of course, are always the same as for the Penrose patterns, always the same. Though I show you only the results. So the I had two answers to this question. The first answer is yes, I can do it like that, but it was first with what we call the cones system. The second answer is yes, I can do it also with smaller tiles, so it can work. And what come, and the very nice thing that come after, it's something that come because, you know, I am a very lazy man. I like when things are very simple. As simple as possible. So I have two tiles. Two tiles, it's enough for me. but I wanted to have some decoration of the style. So I draw here two lines. With one line was not very nice. I need at least two lines. So what can I do with that? You see, this arrangement of rhombus, you have seen it in the previously in the Penrose patterns. okay, you have that in any Penrose pattern. So if I draw the line, my X line here, what I get? Ah, no, I'm not satisfied with that. It doesn't work because I lose the continuity of the red line. But if I do it in the second option, yes, it works nicely. I'm happy with that. So the point is that whatever I do with these two my X stars, I will never go to a Penrose pattern. But I go because the matching rules that imply the line are the same as the matching rules for what we call the binary tiling. Not the Penrose tiling, but binary. And I look here, I draw all possibility to close the space around one vertex. I got this, and you see that my line design some shapes around a vertex, like that. So I'm getting a new set of tiles. And again, I can say this is positive, this is negative. That means that I can use only the negative. And the funny thing is that that set of tiles is very close to what Persian artists called the tone system. What can I do with that? Yes, well, what can I can say now is that any pattern of this family can be designed in a unique way with only the X tiles. So I show you just some two examples. This one in Isfahan again. It's a two-level pattern. That's the whole pattern. Can go, if I get rid of the color, get this, and this can come from my second option of dissection of the tiles, like that. So I think it's a funny thing. Last thing in Turkey, two patterns similar, not in two variations for the same. Of course, when I see it, when I look at that, I know that it can be considered as made from rhombus. I can make it with my tiles. And of course, I never say that the historic artists have used this system. No, 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 definitely not. But it's very funny that it works so nicely. So I think now, that's, I think, according to my quasi clock, I can say it's time to finish now. So thank you, and sorry I'm being a little bit long.